Good afternoon, everybody. We'll get started, so if you can take your seats, and I'll just welcome up the Mayor of Auckland, Len Brown.
Tēnā koutou katoa, and good afternoon, everybody. It's wonderful to see you all here. And I want to acknowledge Professor Edward Glaeser in particular. Edward, it's wonderful to have you here. Thank you for taking the time to come down here to the most distant land at the bottom of the planet. It's wonderful to have you here to share your knowledge, your experience. The book that particularly inspired me is yours, The Triumph of the City. We believe our city is a triumph in the making. I am sure we all look forward to hearing from you today. I want to acknowledge our Deputy Mayor, the many councillors who are here, the local board chairs and representatives who are here, all of the members of our staff, in particular MPs who are here. It's great to see Parliament represented, to everybody who's taken the time to turn up here today. Edward, I'm going to put this Auckland conversation within the context of our city, a little bit of history and a little bit of where we're now at. This is a salutary tale. I want to tell you in particular about a time back in the last century, in the 40s and 50s, when our planners, city leaders and national leaders at that time decided that they needed to get schooled up about how to build a city like Auckland that was growing apace. So they went to Los Angeles. They headed off to Los Angeles and they came away from that visit with the view that Los Angeles was the way in which you should build a city. Suburban bliss, as well as motorways from here to Africa. It was a vision for this city and how we build this city that very much dominated the planning of Auckland really for the next 50 years. As a consequence of that decision, and in the 50s and 60s in particular, we made massive transport changes philosophically and in policy development that had consequences ringing down through the ages. We had 78 kilometres of trams around our city, Edward. We just shut those down in 6 months. We ripped them up. We had a massive bus network. Over the years, we've sort of degenerated that. We had ferries that delivered a huge amount of activity around our harbour. We basically run that down when we put a roading bridge across the harbour. So the options for public transport in the city were by and large kneecapped over a very short period of time. As a consequence of us deciding the best way to build this city was out of motorways and sprawling suburbs. So fast forward 60 years and we have this monochromatic view of Auckland that by and large over the last 10 or 15 years we have addressed through various policy changes and settings and through the public debate. Auckland has by and large not been overly enamoured with the way in which that was done. The first city, the bringing together of Auckland, was really about getting a common vision, a common plan for how we would build this city, deal with the challenges of population growth at between 2 to 2.5% per annum, and really build a city that was reflective of the well-beings of environmental sensitivity, strong economic growth, a city that would genuinely move in terms of its options outside of being perennially gridlocked, and that would have a high focus in bringing our community together, a huge multicultural community here, Edward, something like over 200 different ethnicities and cultures represented in our city. So the first Auckland plan, coming off a vision of creating the world's most livable city, had a high focus on a more compact platform upon which we would build this city. The protection of our rural sector and ensuring that we had a sustainable rural economy. The protecting a stronger focus on our environment and on environmental sustainability. On that basis of environmental sustainability, less carbon discharge coming out of the city built on a more compact platform. More economic activity and energy, just as you write, Edward. A greater sustainable public transport system, not sustainable, of suburban sprawl. A more creative community on the basis that we are living generally in closer communication with each other. More choice around housing. Monochromatic was all about Kiwi quarter acre Pavlova paradise. No choices or very few choices around apartment living, terraced house living, flats living or otherwise, no matter what your stage in life was. We then went into the international marketplace and sought the views of the likes of yourself. What was the state-of-the-art best urban planning, city planning, rather than accidental planning, that we could aspire to and implement in our city at the time of its historic uniting? We had a fellow by the name of Professor Michael Enright, who gave us his view in terms of what would make Auckland a more competitive city, not a more environmentally appropriate or sustainable city, or a city that would move better. What would be the five key shift points that he considered would be appropriate to make Auckland a more competitive city? He said, invest in mass transit, particularly the CRL. That is mediocre. Put your hands together properly. That applause, Edward, actually relates to the last point that I want to make. Really build a great CBD, you know, a great hub, a great heart to the city. Build your economic growth around clusters. Get people connecting and synergising together. Make a more compact city platform. But lastly, and most importantly, get a mindset change in your city around the needs and the challenges of transformation. And we most certainly have now, I believe, the essence of mindset change that is happening in our city. Last Friday was a critical shift from our government in terms of strongly backing Auckland's transport plan in particular, which is predicated off our unitary plan and off that Auckland plan on a whole range of fronts. I believe in transport, infrastructure and housing now. Edward, we have a unique opportunity to present to our people, this nation and the world, a genuine global product of a city completely focused on agreed outcomes. It is an exciting time, Professor Edward Glaeser, for you to be in our city, having given us the benefit of your considerable wisdom and your writings in particular in the book, The Triumph of the City. I in particular love your last paragraph there. It's very aspirational to a city leader, and I'm sure aspiration to all of those who have read your book. Sir, we are delighted that you are here at this time to help us as we go through that change of mindset and transformation of our beautiful city into the world's most livable city. It's great to be here. Enjoy.
Cheers, thanks very much for that, Lynn. I think my mic's on. Yep, great. My name's Jeff Cooper. I'm the Chief Economist here at Auckland Council. I'll be taking us through the rest of the next couple of hours. Just go through the agenda for the session. So I'm going to talk for just a few more minutes just to build the suspense of you listening to Ed first. So put up with me for 15 or so minutes, no more. And then Ed will give us a presentation and address. And then we'll go through to the panel discussion here, where we're going to have our Deputy Mayor Penny Hulse, Robert MacCulloch, who's the Macroeconomics Chair at the University of Auckland, and Arthur Grimes, who is Reserve Bank and also University of Auckland, and Motu as well. Before we go on, I'd just like to thank the sponsors for this event, and particularly the University of Auckland and Motu as well, who have been great in bringing Ed out here. Just one other thing, we're trying out a bit of new technology here this afternoon, and there's an opportunity for you to text through questions or comments, actually, but questions predominantly, and you can do that through texting them to 4040, so it's A-K-L-C-O-N is what you put in first, and then space, and then your question, okay, and you put that through to 4040. Okay, and we'll try and ask as many questions as we can to the panel later on. We also asked you to give us questions before this event, so we've got quite a stack of questions as well to get the panel discussion going. Hopefully that's clear. 4040, up there, A-K-L-C-O-N, space, whatever it is that you want to say or remark. Right, so I think we're here today to talk about cities because the world has, in a sense, sort of become a cluster of cities, hasn't it? And because, in fact, New Zealand is, in many ways, I think, a country of cities. We often don't think of it that way, but in fact it is. And Auckland is our largest and fastest growing city. And it therefore becomes critical to our prosperity, I think, that that how we understand how our policies are affecting the competitiveness of our largest city. And as Chief Economist of Auckland Council, these are the sort of issues that I'm interested in understanding and are very passionate about understanding. So I'm really excited that we're here today to be able to talk about these things through the lens of an economist, because it's not always the lens we look at things through. The Unitary Plan and the Infrastructure Investment Plans are, to me, Auckland's economic policy. They affect our competitiveness. And as such, I think they're critical levers in our aspirations for becoming the high-wage, competitive, knowledge-based economy that's envisaged in the Auckland Plan and the Economic Development Strategy. So given that, I want to talk about three things. I want to talk first about the history of urbanisation, and very short history because I've only got 15 minutes, but the idea that New Zealand is a country of cities, right? The second is the knowledge economy. Okay, I want to talk a little bit about the trade-off that people make when they decide to move to a city, because this trade-off is what Ed spent a lot of his career going into in some detail, and in his words, it is the trade-off between knowledge and space, right? The third thing that I want to talk about is competitiveness, because competitiveness is Auckland's greatest challenge. Okay, it underpins our prosperity as a city. Auckland's competitiveness is an issue of national significance, and as Auckland takes up a greater proportion of New Zealand's population, this will only become more true. So, with any presentation, I think, on Auckland, it's important to start with this slide. And there's a few things that might strike you here. The first is that this is going back to the 1930s there. You'll see that most of New Zealand's cities dating back to the 1930s were actually of a similar size. And in fact, Dunedin was New Zealand's biggest city prior to that as well. Since then, only one New Zealand city has grown with any gusto, and only one New Zealand city is expected to grow with any gusto. So that's interesting in itself, but the other point that's interesting is the fact that New Zealand has become a much more urbanised country, right? At the turn of the 20th century, 40% of New Zealanders lived in cities. Now 85% of New Zealanders live in cities. So if you have a look at rural versus urban growth, from 1881 to 2001, rural growth has increased by 83%, while urban growth has increased by 1,500%. And it is hard to think that this is not somehow quite a good thing, right? It means people are taking and managing to access opportunities, employment opportunities, better wages, and in a sense they are here because they are better here than somewhere else. That's what they're saying. And Auckland's population projections project this to continue, right? And also, I think that is somehow a very good thing, because two-thirds of all of that growth is going to be our children and our children's children. And the other third is going to be skilled labour, which is going to help the businesses grow that we need for us to be here as well. But why are people moving to cities? I think this is what a lot of the population questions are about. Why are people moving here? We know a lot about the costs. We know a lot about the transport costs. We know a lot about the costs perception of density and having people around us. We talk a lot about those in the media, but what we don't talk about is the benefits of cities, and that's what I want to quickly sort of talk about. Not ready for that slide yet. We'll get there. So I want to talk about the economy, my second point. I grew up in a place called Cambridge, which is it's sort of a rural town, about 30 minutes away from Hamilton. And the thing that sort of strikes me when I think about my time in Cambridge is the amount of space that everybody in Cambridge has, right? If everybody wanted to have their own sort of Eden Park outer oval, they could, right? Or cricket ground, you know, and it wouldn't be a cricket ground with short boundaries. It could be like the SCG or the MCG or something. It'd be massive, right? There's a lot of space there. And so when I moved to Auckland, I was making an explicit trade-off about land and knowledge, right? So this is a trade-off which is at the heart of public discourse right now at the moment. It's a trade-off to me that explains centuries of migration from rural to urban life. And it's also a trade-off which Ed has been spending much of his academic life studying, articulating, and exposing with unparalleled clarity in his field. People living in cities are prepared to trade off space for knowledge. And that's what these graphs say. This is the economist's way of looking at it, just saying, well, land prices are going up, and they're going up because there's more demand for land. This is what it looks like in terms of markets. Okay, so the picture on your left there is what you can buy in Cambridge for the median house price in Auckland. The one on the right is an apartment that you can buy in Auckland. So this is what I'm talking about. People are, in a sense, prepared to trade off space in order to access knowledge. That's what this is. That's what the difference between those two things are for me. So urbanisation, in a sense, shows us that for many, ideas and amenities and leisure and all of these things have become more important commodities than grass and dirt. Space now has a premium. But why? The answer is in the knowledge economy. We've got Dave Mare here from Motu, who's a senior fellow there with us today. And Dave's done a lot of work in this area, looking specifically at how people are more productive when they're around other people. And he estimated that in Auckland, in the Auckland region, workers are 30 to 50% more productive value add per worker than the rest of New Zealand. And if you go into a more dense area where the density of employment is heightened, that figure goes up. So for the city centre area, it's 139%. Right? This is astonishing, right? That's a big figure. So knowledge can be used in ways in Auckland that it cannot be used in other parts of the country. Indeed, knowledge can be used in the city centre in ways that cannot be used outside of the city centre. And that's why businesses locate there. It's because of density, it's because of deep labour markets, large market sizes. Auckland is a remarkably productive New Zealand city. In fact, if the rest of New Zealand grew with the same productivity as Auckland, New Zealand's GDP would be in the order of 26% higher. That's what we're talking about. This is the knowledge economy, and it explains a great deal of Auckland's success. But the success doesn't just go to newcomers, right? It's not just the next worker that comes over from Australia when they do come over here. Current residents are also better off, and this is something that Ed and his colleagues, I think, have been hugely instrumental in demonstrating. And one study that Ed and his colleagues were able to do was show that as the share of graduate students in a metropolitan area goes up by 10%, your wages go up by 8%. Okay? That's what we mean by when economists talk about agglomeration with density. That's the economic effects of it. And I think this is one reason why Ed calls our cities our greatest invention. Of course, additional people also add extra costs to a city. But all too often, I think that these economic benefits are forgotten about in discussions of spatial form and population growth. We ought to do more to remember them in Auckland because this city is a leader for the market and ideas. We're a leader in the area of education. And that means that space is valued much more highly in Auckland than it is in other places. And we see this in prices. So 78% of all the intellectual property applications made by firms in cities last year were made in Auckland. 55% of postgraduate students across New Zealand in 2011 came from Auckland's three biggest educational institutions. Auckland is an educated city of people with ideas which can benefit all of us. So it's quite simple. As employment density goes up, your wages go up. And this is not an idea that has sort of just sprung up recently. This here is a quote from a guy called Alfred Marshall, who's considered by many to be one of the sort of four founding fathers of economics, where he said, "So great are the advantages which people follow the same skilled trade get from near neighbourhood to one another." And he goes on, "We follow the fortune of groups of skilled workers who are gathered within the narrow boundaries of a thickly peopled industrial district." This is from 1890. These words are still in our economic development strategy today. So the idea that we can do more with knowledge in Auckland and that should have a positive and uplifting influence on land prices shouldn't really surprise us. It's just a result of people valuing proximity, valuing knowledge, valuing amenity. And it's not because people are telling people that you must be more dense, that you must locate closer to each other. It's because, in a sense, we know that we're better off doing so. And we do that because there are employment opportunities there to do so. So this is what Auckland's population projections tell me as an economist. They are saying that knowledge will increasingly become more important to Auckland. And I think this is an important insight of Ed's work as well about education. So let me finish off just by talking about competitiveness. I want to conclude by talking about competitiveness because Auckland will only experience the benefits promised of a more competitive, of a more compact city if we remain competitive. This is a bottom line, right? The good news is that Auckland does very well nationally, right? Very well. This is one thing that population growth tells us, right? As some are saying we're almost doing too well. but the bad news is that we don't really compete against other New Zealand cities, right? We compete against cities like Singapore, like Hong Kong, Melbourne, Sydney. Auckland lost 18,000 people to Australia last year. It's the highest on record. We're in a global fight to retain these ideas that we're generating in Auckland. And this is one of the striking themes of Ed's work. The fortune of cities relies heavily on its ability to attract ideas and talent. The right environment for capital skills is critical to us all. But if we're unable to move with the times, if we're unnecessarily stifle the choices that people want to make, if we prevent people from gaining knowledge by making it difficult for them to trade off land and space, if we lose the battle of congestion by trying to build our way out of it, if we do all of these things, we might end up finding that our children are living abroad, not here. And that's something that we should be honest about, I think. The idea itself worries me because cities don't have to grow. Many don't grow. Many cities don't grow. Detroit lost 60% of its population over the last 60 years. Dunedin has hardly registered anything on their population map for 50 or 60 years. Cities don't have to grow. Growth is a sign of success, and to me it's one of Auckland's most exciting traits. And if well managed, it has the potential to benefit us all. Thomas Friedman once famously remarked that the world is flat. I think Thomas is wrong in this respect. I think, in the words of Philip McCann, the world is much more spiky than it is flat. It is cities that create opportunities. Cities are the beacon of innovation. And Auckland does this better than any other city in New Zealand. The problem is that we need to be nipping on the heels of the cities in front of us rather than staying in front of the cities behind us. And Ed's work helps us understand how to do this. That's why he's with us speaking here today. So on that note, it's my great pleasure to introduce Ed Glaeser to the stage. When I first mentioned to some of my colleagues that Ed was coming out here, they referred to him as the godfather of economics, urban economics, and I think this is sort of quite appropriate. Ed has led much of the economic discourse on cities over the last decade or so, covering topics such as competitiveness, housing affordability, land use policy, industrial diversity, transport and inequality. He obtained his BA in economics from Princeton University and has a PhD in economics from the University of Chicago. Ed joined the faculty of Harvard in 92, where he teaches urban and social economics and microeconomic theory. He's authored various books. The most recent one is The Triumph of the City, and I highly recommend you read this book. It explains with great clarity why cities are our greatest ever invention and why they make us richer, smarter, greener, healthier, and happier. So without any further ado, it's my great pleasure to invite the 2013 Sir Douglas Myers Visiting Professor, Professor Ed Glaeser. Cheers.
I am really thrilled and honored to be here. I was originally told that this was going to be a small, intimate policy discussion with maybe a few support staff for the council. So I made my slides deliberately wonky, and I have to apologize for that. But on the honored side, or just the delighted side, I was just thinking through about why it's just such a great thing to be in Auckland. I mean, obviously, the city is spectacular. I mean, and it's spectacular not just in terms of the physical aspects of the city. The first thing I did when I got off the plane was go running in the Domain this morning, which sort of, you know, reminds us of the incredible beauty of this place. But it's spectacular in terms of its human capital. I mean, the amount of talent that it's in this room in this city is really extraordinary. And I think another way in which it's spectacular is that I think you're really, you know, giving Singapore a run for its money in terms of being the best managed place on the planet. Right? One thing that economists have long believed is that competition is good. There are lots of good things that come from it. Now, Auckland, and to a lesser extent New Zealand as a whole understands that no one has granted you success on a platter, that you are not foreordained to be one of the great cities of the world. You will become a great city. You are a great city because you are led by people who understand that you have to keep on fighting for that, day in and day out, to produce something that's fantastic. And that's a great thing to see. That realization is a great thing to be aware of. So I'm thrilled to be here. And I think the last reason I think that's thrilling is that while New Zealand has a bit of this strange American tendency of being a nation of urbanites, but full of urbanites who do not think that they live in cities, right? And you talked about the Los Angeles model. The wonderful thing about Los Angeles, actually nobody in Los Angeles thinks they're an urbanite, right? They look outside of their door and they see palm trees and they think that they're a yeoman farmer. I often have the sense that is true of many of the people who live in lower density Auckland as well, that they are deeply part of an urban system, and yet they think that they're, pioneering in the wilderness. All right, I want to start with a portrait of America. And since there are assuredly some people with architectural backgrounds here, I hope that this portrait makes it clear from the very start that I have absolutely no aesthetic sense whatsoever. But a portrait it is nonetheless. And what I've done is I've taken the 3,000-odd counties in the United States, and I've split them into 10 shares on the basis of density. Because at their hearts, cities are the absence of physical space between people and firms. Since cities are density, proximity, closeness. Now, what the bottom line shows is the relationship between density and income across America's counties. As you can see, the line runs straight up, and the most dense tenth of America's counties have income levels that are on average 50% higher than the least dense tenth of America's counties. This is the phenomenon that was already discussed called agglomeration economies, that the three largest metropolitan areas in the United States produce 18% of America's GDP, while including only 13% of America's population. And the fact was put forward that if all of the productivity of New Zealand went up to Auckland's level, what was your number, 26%? 26%. In the U.S., the number for New York productivity is 43% of how much GDP would go up. This is a widely studied topic within economics. We've spent, years, decades obsessing over what causes this. Dave and I actually started working on this about 20 years ago, and one of the facts that's really interesting is that when people come to cities, they don't immediately receive the full wage premium associated with living in that city. But year after year, month after month, their wages go up more quickly than the residents of low-density areas, which I think is compatible with a view of cities that they are forges of human capital, places that we get smart by being around other smart people. Now, the top line shows something that is at least somewhat more surprising to American audiences, although should not be surprising to an audience that is well aware of Auckland's outsized growth over the last 40 years. But what you see in the other line is that population growth rises with initial density levels. Those places that had the least land initially had the fastest population growth over the next 10 years. So this is starting in the year 2000. So whereas America at the start of the 19th century left its dense enclaves on the eastern seaboard to populate the empty spaces between the oceans, at the start of the 21st century, America is, instead of spreading out, it's clustering in. And of course, that's exactly what we've seen in New Zealand as well. Now, accompanying this rise of high incomes and population growth is, of course, prices. Now, there are many downsides to high prices, and I'm going to return to that later. But on some very basic level, the price of an area shows how much people are willing to pay to be there. And what this growth shows is that by fifth the population density, I'm looking at price changes between 1996 and 2012 across America's metropolitan areas. And what you see there is that the growth in prices in the most dense fifth of America's metropolitan areas is 20% over this time period. In the least dense four-fifths, it's under 6%. Enormous difference, enormous growth of people's willingness to pay to be in these areas. Now, this is just, I'm even going to skip over this, but this is just the incredible difference in incomes within New Zealand. In fact, Auckland's outstanding level here. This is another way of seeing the growth. This is net migration by regions in Australia since 1980, and all of the spiky stuff is that Auckland line, right? All of the extra net migration. Everything else is rounding error relative to what's happening in terms of Auckland growth, which is why it is crucial that the country understands the future of New Zealand depends upon this metropolitan region thriving. Now, of course, the The success of cities in New Zealand, in the US, in Europe is nothing relative to what's happening in the developing countries of the world, right? We've recently passed that amazing halfway point where more than 50% of humanity now lives in cities. And it's hard not to think that on net, that's a good thing, because when you compare those countries that are more than 50% urbanized to those countries that are less than 50% urbanized, income levels are on average 5 times higher in those countries that are more than 50% urbanized, and infant mortality levels are less than a third. Right, and one of the responses you often get back to this is people who have visited Mumbai or Delhi, and they come there from their wealthy world experiences, and they think, oh, these places are hell holes. You can't possibly imagine this. It's all a terrible mistake that people are moving there. Well, what happens is these people actually don't visit rural India. And if you visit rural India, you have a very different picture of what Delhi and Mumbai are actually offering. The people who are moving to these cities by the millions are not fools or idiots. They're actually following opportunity. And cities in these countries are what cities have been doing successfully for millennia. They're providing pathways out of poverty into prosperity. Gandhi famously said that the future of India is not in its cities, but in its villages. But on this one, with all due respect to the great man, he was completely and utterly wrong, because in fact it is the cities of India that are providing its future, and a future that is not just more economically productive, but is more socially inclusive and is more politically decent as well. Now, this relatively positive view of the city, this view that says that despite the death of distance, urban proximity is becoming more, not less important, and that is a central paradox of the age, but that rosy view of cities is very different from the New York City of my youth. So I was born in Manhattan in 1967, and these were two iconic images from the pages of the media when I was a kid. That image is Gerald Ford, who did not literally say to New York City, "Drop dead," when he turned New York's desire for a bailout down, but lots of people think he actually meant it. And certainly during those years, it felt not just that President Ford, but that history itself was telling all of the older, colder cities of America that they were headed for the trash heap of history. And of course, it wasn't just America, it was London, too. For those of you who remember London in the 70s, this was a very grim experience. The age of the industrial city was over, and it wasn't clear that anything was going to replace it. Indeed, it looked as if cities were dinosaurs, headed for the trash heap of history, where once great urban areas were going to be reclaimed by the weeds, as the South Bronx is apparently being reclaimed by the weeds, as President Jimmy Carter marches through it. And it really seemed plausible that we were headed towards some age where the Statue of Liberty would poke out of the sand, as it does at the end of the Planet of the Apes, in a world of sort of post-urban existence. One of the reasons why this seems so plausible is that cities seem to have lost their function, right? Cities in much of the world were nodes on a transportation network, right? What is Auckland but a port ultimately, right? That's why these things came about. All of America's older, colder cities were built on major waterways. In 1900, all 20 large American cities were, from the oldest cities, typically where the river meets the sea, to the newest, Minneapolis, on the northernmost navigable point on the Mississippi River. And of course, great industry grew up around those transportation networks. Now, these were places already in the 19th century of remarkable innovation. Right, Chicago gave us the skyscraper, Detroit gave us the mass-produced automobile. Right, but even these innovations had led to an urban model that was fundamentally antithetical to what cities do well. So out of a maelstrom of entrepreneurship and innovation in late 19th century Detroit, we got this, right? Ford's great factories. Now, on one level, this is a fantastic recipe for short-run productivity. These things were, you know, paying $5 days. They were the model of the world. They made Detroit quite possibly the most productive place on the planet in 1950. But on another level, this model is completely antithetical to what cities do well. If you go back before this industrial age to the cities of the age of Matthew Bolton's Birmingham or Alexander Hamilton's New York, you find that successful cities are marked by three things: small firms, smart people, and connections to the outside world. The same three factors are strongly correlated with urban success today. How different from that is Ford's River Rouge plant, a vast, vertically integrated plant walled off from the outside world, employing tens of thousands of adults with very, very few amounts of formal education. Right? This type of factory follows the logic of cost minimization. When it is cheap to locate in Detroit, you locate in Detroit. But when those transportation costs fall and you're freed from being near the Great Lakes, you move to where costs are cheaper. You move to states with more pro-business regulations within the U.S. You move to lower-cost locations elsewhere. The age of the industrial city in the West was over by the 1970s, and it wasn't clear what was going to replace it.
This is the decline of the cost of moving goods that set this off. The price of moving a ton of mile by rail in the U.S. declined by 90% over the course of the 20th century. So those one-time advantages of being near the Great Lakes disappeared. And one way of thinking about what this did is it freed population up. So in 1900, you located near the Great Lakes, you located near the coal mines. As transportation costs plummeted, you moved to places where people wanted to live. You moved to consumer cities instead of producer cities. And apparently, we already mentioned Los Angeles, which is the archetype of such a thing. And apparently, the data suggests that what American consumers really wanted was somewhat warmer winters. Because there's no variable that better predicts population growth across the 20th century than January temperature. And this is true in virtually any country that we have data on it. Right, so within the country, the move is towards more temperate zones. This is over the last 10 years. Now, it turns out there are several things embedded in this in the U.S. These places have also typically had more pro-business regulation. These places have also had typically more pro-housing regulation. But there's no question that people also thought that Chicago winters were a little bit less pleasant than Los Angeles ones were. Along with the move to sun was the move to sprawl. We have always built our cities around the transportation technology that was dominant in the era in which they were being created. We go to the oldest cities of Europe or even in the United States. They're built on pedestrian scales with short, narrow streets, right? Short blocks, easy to walk around with. Often the streets wind following the natural course of a person's walk or even the path of a goat, right? You move then to cities that are built around the omnibus era, around the era of street rail or about elevated railways. These were all the sprawl of their era, right? They're not fundamentally different than cities built around the car, which were the 20th century innovation. We were always redesigning our urban spaces around that transportation technology. There is, however, one difference between all of those older forms of structures and the car-based living. Cars require and enable vastly larger amounts of space to be put between the houses. Because all of those older things, you still had to walk from the omnibus stop or the street rail line to your final destination. Cars point to point, right? Just enables and requires a vast amount of space. It totally changes things in lots of ways. These are examples of mass-produced car-related structures in the U.S. The top one is Levittown, early mass-produced housing outside of New York and Philadelphia. The bottom is the Woodlands, a vast, far more luxurious project outside of Houston. Now, hit by the move to sun and sprawl and deindustrialization, this is what happened to the 10 largest cities in America in 1950. We barely remember that these places were once urban giants, right? Three of them, Cleveland, Detroit, St. Louis, have lost more than 50% of their populations. Five of them have lost more than 20%. Only two of them have gained, New York and Los Angeles. Now, the decline of these cities was not helped by the fact that the federal government in the U.S. followed essentially a Potemkin village strategy to urban redevelopment. Now, the core thing to remember in cities, right, is that the real heart of the city is never the structures, is never the infrastructure, it's the people. And all of this other stuff exists to enable people and to make them more productive. Now, a lot of the time, that's, you know, a fairly minor point. When you look at growing cities need infrastructure, and that's absolutely part of the equation. But the connection between growth and infrastructure that you often see appears to have convinced America's planners, and Europe was not free of this as well, that the way to stem decline was to do what growing cities did, doing put down new infrastructure, put down new buildings in urban renewal projects, put down a monorail in Detroit after the Federal Highway Aid Act of 1973. Now, this misses the whole point about decline. The hallmark of declining cities is they have an abundance of structures and infrastructure relative to the level of demand. More than 90% of the homes in Central City Detroit are valued at significantly below construction costs. If they fell down, no one in their right mind would put them up again. Indeed, they're paying a lot right now to get rid of them so they can make the space less dangerous. Right? Detroit never needed a monorail. Look at the streets below that monorail. They're empty. Okay? It is easy to drive around Central City Detroit. There's nobody there on the streets. And yet there they are building themselves a monorail because of the magic that would come from this. This is an important thing to remember about infrastructure. Infrastructure needs, and I know full well that the rail line has in Auckland has been subjected to enormous amounts of cost-benefit analysis, which is great. But infrastructure needs to be judged by cost-benefit analysis, not by some ridiculous magic that if you put this monorail, Detroit will in fact come back. Now, luckily, the story of cities doesn't end with Detroit, although Detroit lost another 25% of its population in the last decade alone, right, suggesting that it is nowhere near close to solving its problems. But it's easy to forget that once Seattle looked a lot like Detroit. In 1971, two real estate jokers put up a sign on the highway leading out of the city asking the last person to leave Seattle to please turn out the lights. Because Boeing, mighty Boeing, had been cutting back on its employment, and just as no one could imagine a Detroit with a smaller General Motors, no one could imagine a Seattle with a smaller Boeing, right? Now, of course, that's before Amazon, before Microsoft, before Costco, and Starbucks is at best the faint whiff of an aroma in a coffee roaster's nostrils, right? Entrepreneurs, companies that didn't exist in 1971, came and filled up the space made by Boeing. Why? Why did that happen in Seattle? Why not in Detroit? That is ultimately the question. Because cities will always be shedding old industries. And for them to survive, they always need to be creating new industries. Now, one of the things that's really interesting about new technologies like this is the way that they interact with urban life. This is a picture of Zipcar. Okay. Zipcar builds itself as being a part of a sharing economy, and in a way it is, but there's nothing new about sharing in cities. What is a restaurant, an urban invention, other than shared eating space? What is a park other than shared greensward, right? Cities have always been in the sharing business. What's interesting about these new technologies is they increase the range of things that we can share to make it easier to share automobiles. I was just thinking about what it would be like if we tried to share automobiles in New York in 1975. Wouldn't last a week, right? I mean, the thing would be totaled in 5 days by some guy who had left it somewhere, and you'd never be able to figure out who totaled it. Now, with technology, we know who totaled it, and they'd be on the hook for the thing. The technology increases the range of sharing. Now, the one variable that explains, that predicts which of these older, colder cities manage to come back is skills, is education. And when I think about the things that cities have to do right, nothing is more important than producing, attracting and retaining skilled people. This is the relationship between population growth between the years 2000 and 2010 and the share of the population with a college degree as of the year 2000. Skills really are destiny, right? They are incredibly important. The most important economic development strategy is to attract and retain smart people and then get out of their way, right? That is not a job for laissez-faire. Attracting and retaining smart people is incredibly hard work, and it's all about those quality of life strategies that we were talking about. Right? But quality of life is not some add-on to economic development. It is the heart of economic development, because it's not as if the city government's going to be great at inculcating entrepreneurship on its own. What it should be great at is creating a city that entrepreneurs actually want to live in. And that's what fundamentally urban success is all about. This is the relationship between per capita GDP and the share of adults with college degrees across the U.S. As you can see, an enormously tight correlation, as was already mentioned, typically as the share of the population with a college degree goes up by 10%, your wages go up by 8%, holding your years of schooling constant. This is across the countries in the world, the relationship between PISA math scores and per capita income, right? Just look at how powerful that is. Just look at how tight that correlation is, right? I mean, in the 21st century, I think people can't expect to be paid more than their skills actually merit. Now, the good thing is, New Zealand looks pretty good on this, at least relative to the U.S. So we are, of course, in green letters, the U.S., because this was done by American economists. This is PISA math scores, the share of students who achieve advanced in math. This is New Zealand, right? Between Liechtenstein and the Czech Republic, behind Netherlands, Belgium, Switzerland, Finland, Korea, Hong Kong, and Taiwan. So there's plenty of room to grow, right? You're not Taiwan, you're not Hong Kong. But that's pretty good company. Here we are. We're a little bit short of Lithuania, the U.S. We're sort of dreaming of being Ireland or Norway or Poland. And interspersed are U.S. states, so Massachusetts does better on this. But these skill levels really are critical. And when you think about sort of what it is that Auckland needs to do, it needs to be about the quality of education that's given to the kids growing up here. But it's also very much about attracting skilled people from outside the country. And certainly from an American perspective, I am fully committed to fighting for better schools in America, but somehow or other I find it more plausible that we're going to get more skilled people by increasing the number of H-1B visas than I do that we're really going to fix our public school problem. This is the rate of growth in test scores over the past 20 years. There's New Zealand. Again, it's doing slightly better than the OECD average in terms of growth, but it's less sort of outsized there. And often this is the U.S., which does slightly worse than that, about the norm. Do notice that while it's possible to really screw this up, this is Sweden. Okay, Sweden went from having a place that had a fantastic school system to being a place that's become a basket case over the last 15 years. It's very easy to do, and having a national curriculum, as New Zealand does, increases the risks of actually doing something wrong. Note that I'm not saying anything remotely critical of the way things are currently running. I think it's great, but it is, in fact, there are potential risks here. I'll just skip over these things. There is a great resurgence of information on schools, four types of findings that we know about. Teacher quality is the most important ingredient, both to test scores and to adult earnings. We have great new studies that look at what happens when teachers randomly come in the middle of a year to students' test scores. This is what happens. They burst up when good teachers show up, right? And when the teachers leave, they go down. The same teachers, this is comparing the teacher's effect on test scores with the teacher's effects on earnings as 30-year-olds using IRS, using tax-linked data. Same teachers who raise test scores raise earnings by a very significant degree. This is something worth paying for. If you can actually get better teachers in, this is absolutely critical. This is the test score relationship. Charter schools, right, have had enormously positive effect in the U.S. This is by comparing lottery winners with lottery losers in charters. One way to think about this is getting things that involve more competition in school systems harnesses the natural virtues of cities of competition and innovation. Right? One way to think about what New York did with its public school districts is it's as if you took every restaurant in New York and you turned it into a single state-run canteen. Right? And you lost everything that was good about having all that innovation. Having some degree of variation makes things better. But of course, the key point on education is America has far more to learn from New Zealand than New Zealand has from the United States. I would just say one thing that is really explosive in this, and what's critical here is to constantly measure outcomes, is the e-learning does not, I think, offer necessarily a way of drastically increasing the amount of information that's given to kids, but the constant measurement of what kids are learning through constant taking of tests online enables schools to radically improve the quality of their curriculum because you can actually test what works in a very quick, real-time basis, and that's sort of one of the things that we're seeing that's really particularly hopeful. Now, as someone who teaches in an academic setting, I am frequently amazed that anything I teach has any value in the real world whatsoever. Right? It's not fundamentally, you know, it doesn't seem fundamentally right to me in some way relative to the utter impracticality of most of what I and my fellow academics know. The most important skills of cities are the stuff that's learned on the streets. Right? It's that Alfred Marshall stuff about how in dense clusters the mysteries of the trade become no mystery but are, as it were, in the air. And when I think of the things that are taught on the street, nothing is more important for the life of the city than the skills and inclination to be an entrepreneur. The economist Ben Chinnitz, 50 years ago, was comparing New York and Pittsburgh and noting that New York appeared to be more resilient than Pittsburgh did even then. And he argued that this was a result of a culture of entrepreneurship in New York that had been inculcated by New York's industrial past. The largest industrial cluster in the United States in the 1950s was not automobile production in Detroit, it was garment production in New York. But garment production differs in a substantial way from automobile production. It is an industry with very low returns to scale. It is an industry in which anyone with a good idea and a couple of sewing machines can get started. And as such, the garment district was a mother of entrepreneurship, right? Leading to people who built skyscrapers or started Hollywood. All of these people started as small-scale entrepreneurs in the garment district because this entrepreneurial stuff, right? When one industry doesn't work, you think of something new to do because that's what the business of an entrepreneur is. You're supposed to be looking for something new. Right? If it doesn't work for you to be in the garment district, you start doing an e-greeting card, right? You're just looking for opportunity. By contrast, Pittsburgh had U.S. Steel, right? Vast vertically integrated companies, and what those companies do is they train company men. They train middle managers who make this vast enterprise work. Now, this is, again, a great thing for short-run productivity, but if U.S. Steel falters, these guys aren't going to be starting an e-greeting company. Right? They're going to have no idea what they're supposed to be doing. They're going to be sending out resumes to find some other large company to employ them because those are their skills. Right? Now, the remarkable thing is how well the data turned out to support Chinnitz's view. We have remarkably poor proxies for local entrepreneurship, which makes it even more remarkable that they are so powerful. One of those proxies is the average establishment size. So what we've done here is we've just ranked metropolitan areas by average establishment size. So the one down there that says one, those have the smallest average establishments. The one over there that has five, those have the biggest firms. Average employment growth in those metropolitan areas between 1977 and 2010 with the smallest firms, close to 200%. In the largest firms, under 40%, right? Massive differences, and this is true within city as well, comparing those industries, clusters that are more entrepreneurial versus those that are less. It's true using any number of measures of this, controlling for anything that you like. Small firms, a legacy of entrepreneurship is associated with success, whereas big firms are not. This is by share of employment in new establishments, 1977, a similarly large effect. Now the question is, what do governments do about this, right? Governments frequently recognize that entrepreneurs are important, but what does that mean for government policy? Now, one of the popular ways to do things is by lending money to entrepreneurs. And entrepreneurs, of course, love this as well. And every entrepreneur has a story about how, you know, the short-sightedness of local venture capitalists, right? We've got, you know, yeah, we've got venture capitalists in Boston, but they're short-sighted. Now, that, of course, means they won't fund you, right? That doesn't necessarily mean that there's any actual market failure there. It just means that they deemed you unworthy. But somehow or other, the government is going to be better at this job, according to this narrative, than the private venture capital industry. Now, there's a wonderful book by my colleague, Josh Lerner, called Boulevard of Broken Dreams, that highlights the tremendous array of failures throughout the world when governments start going into the venture capital business and how poor governments are at picking winners and losers. One of the most famous examples of this, of course, is Japanese Ministry of International Trade and Industrialization, which in the 1980s, along with all things Japanese, down to wasabi sauce, was claimed to be the miracle behind Japanese productivity growth. Now, we haven't heard so much about these Japanese miracles of the 20 years since then, but there was a whole cottage industry of the 80s about how, you know, which Japanese feature was responsible for Japan's success. Again, if you ask me, it's human capital. It was skills, but it wasn't complicated. But MIDI was argued to be one of the things. Now, two economists, Beeson and Weinstein, went and they studied those firms that got MIDI support. MIDI backed losers, okay, relative to the Japanese firms that didn't get MIDI support. MIDI was actually not choosing high flyers. They weren't funding the firms that were transforming Japan. They were transforming the old industrial giants that were declining over time. Right? This happens over and over again in terms of government policies. Now, cluster strategies. I see more upside in this, but again, it's hard. For every Silicon Valley that works out well, there's another one that doesn't. Boston's currently betting on this thing called the Innovation District. This is the Boston structure. So they're taking a bunch of old industrial land and they're trying to make it into a hub for entrepreneurs. It will almost assuredly succeed because this is very prime real estate in one of the most entrepreneurship-heavy sectors of the world, and which is in an area that is crying out for more space. Right? That does not necessarily mean that this was the best use of this land or that this was a great structure, a great design, but it is, in fact, a very low-risk one. Now, education is another area which we know that there's value. So the work of Naomi Hausman founds that when individual scientists were allowed to commercialize the findings they had, thanks to government grants after the Bayh-Dole Act of 1980, there was an outpouring of local entrepreneurship in related firms, right? So one way to work this at the national level is to competitively support research. But the low-hanging fruit is eliminating barriers to entry, is carving those regulations that make it difficult to start firms. Now, as I'm sure many of you know, according to doing business across the world, the World Bank study, New Zealand isn't like in the top five or the top 10. New Zealand is actually number one in the world in this, right? Post the reforms of the past 25 years, New Zealand has become the easiest place, according to the World Bank, to start a new business, and that's fantastic. And I think when we talk about sort of the flourishing of entrepreneurship in New Zealand, some of it has to do with education and skills, which are abundant, but some of it also has to do with the fact that the government has moved towards having a more startup-friendly, startup-intensive view. And that's great. Now, the most entrepreneurial place on the planet I've ever been is actually not in Silicon Valley or in London or even in New Zealand. It's the Dharavi slum of Mumbai. Right? Because you walk down the streets and you see in one shop a couple of guys and they're sewing brassieres and you think you're in the Lower East Side of Manhattan in 1906. And then you go across and there are people who are recycling boxes, and that means you chop the boxes up and you turn them around so you can't see the old labels, and then you staple them up and send them out to somebody else. Who knew there was a market for this? But you know, they were in the heart of a city, so they knew. And then a little bit further down there's a ceramics cluster. And they're making these beautiful little pots that they're so proud of, they won't even take money from you to pay for them. I mean, just a remarkable thing, right? And it really makes you feel the promise of Indian human capital, of Indian entrepreneurship. And then, of course, you walk outside and there's a kid defecating in the streets, right? And you know the electricity won't run and the water isn't clean, right? And it reminds you that not everything about cities is great, that those cities are, in fact, enabling the entrepreneurship of those people. But You know, there are also downsides of density. If two people are close enough to exchange an idea face-to-face, they're also close enough to exchange a contagious disease. And if someone's close enough to sell you a newspaper or a beautiful ceramic pot, they're also probably close enough to pick your pocket. And for 3,000 years, cities have been battling these demons that come with density. Contagious disease, most of all, because the most important job for city government is clean water. Because if you don't provide clean water, people die on a large scale from cholera, right? And this making cities livable was an enormous challenge in terms of this, right? America's cities and towns were spending as much on water at the start of the 20th century as the federal government was spending on everything except for the post office and the army. Similar investments were required in Europe over the same time period. This wasn't small potatoes. And when I think about, you know, there are aspects of land use planning that I'm sort of all gung-ho on regulating less, but when it comes to the personal safety stuff, it's fine to regulate. I mean, it's fine to make sure that we need actually a government to actually make sure that people are safe, and particularly if we're looking at the potential downsides of earthquake activity, which is in some sense the modern equivalent of a cholera epidemic, right? This is another area in which serious government intervention is entirely appropriate. A second demon of density is crime. I'm not going to talk very much about crime here. If people want to talk about it in the panel, I can later, but you seem to solve this problem, so I'm not going to waste any of your time on it. When I talk in Latin America, we spend a lot of time on crime. Traffic congestion and the high cost of living in poverty. Now, I just want to say two things quickly about traffic congestion. Now, water was solved with engineering miracles, with vastly expensive projects, and you could really just engineer your way out of this. You can't engineer your way out of traffic congestion. There's something called the fundamental law of highway congestion, which is that vehicle miles traveled increase roughly 1 for 1 with highway miles built. If you build it, they will drive it, okay? You can't just build more highways and expect to handle the problem, because people adjust their lifestyles in order to take account of all that free space. You've got to charge people for valuable assets if you expect them to use them properly. Now, in the old Soviet Union, right, this always works well when I'm sort of, you know, talking to a right-wing audience. I accuse people who are against congestion pricing of being communists. That's, but I'm going to do it again here, although I suspect that has less of a pejorative tone. But in the old Soviet Union, right, they used to, you know, give away groceries for pennies on the dollar. And the result wasn't that everyone got groceries. The result was long lines and stockouts. Right? That's what we do with urban city streets. Right? We provide access to urban city streets for a fraction of the social cost of providing that access, of a fraction of the social cost of driving on that street, and the result is the urban equivalent of long lines and traffic and stockouts, which is urban traffic jams. There's only one natural way to handle this, which is to do what Singapore has done and have electronic road pricing. Some of the highest returns from this is, of course, rationalizing the use of the infrastructure at the time of the day. Right? It's crucial that you have a system that can actually make the cost a lot higher for driving at 7:30 a.m. than for driving either at 6:30 a.m. or at 9:30 a.m. because you want to use these pricing to push people out. Now, I am well aware, right? We live in countries with similar politics in many ways, although there are some substantial differences. I am not saying this because I believe that the failure to adopt congestion pricing in either New Zealand or the US is a result of a lack of information on this. I am well aware of the political problems of putting this through. I will just say one thing, though. On any new highway, it is infinitely easier to get this stuff in than on any old highway. Right, because there's an endowment effect that is very powerful. If people are used to driving for a street on for free, taking it away from them is close to impossible. If it's a new highway, if you wait for the second day, you're done. But if you get it in on the first day, it's possible, it's doable, and it has been done again and again. So I would just stress, any new highway, it comes in, start thinking about moving on congestion pricing right now, for political, not for economic reasons in some sense. I would do the whole city on congestion pricing if you could. Now, if cities are able to deal with the demons that come with density, obviously they can become places of tremendous pleasure as well as productivity. Right, the same urban innovation and competition that makes for great software companies or great management consulting firms also makes for great restaurants. And the urban ability to share, right, that sort of sharing economy makes it possible to share great forms of infrastructure like great museums or symphony halls or parks. Right? All of this is part of the triumph of the city, and it's the part of the city that's most lovable, that's most humane. But the downside of even that side is that prices can get out of whack. This is what's happened to prices close to the city center versus places outside of the city center. And this is another way of looking at this. So the rising line shows Manhattan's prices from 1960 on, where the declining line shows Manhattan's permits. So just as New York was getting its act together, both in terms of economic success and then subsequent to that, its improvements in the quality of life, the declines in crime, it was making it more and more difficult to build. What happened, therefore, was that rising demand collided against essentially fixed supply. This is economics 101. You don't have to look further than those twin scissors that Alfred Marshall was so eloquent about. When booming demand hits fixed supply, the result is very, very high prices. And a city risks becoming a boutique town, affordable only to the wealthy. Now, there are so many things that the great urbanist Jane Jacobs got right. But this one she actually got wrong, because Jacobs looked at old buildings and new buildings and noted that old buildings were cheap and new buildings were expensive, which led her to the conclusion that the way to promote affordability was to make sure that no one built any new buildings on top of old buildings. Now, that is not how supply and demand works. And you don't need to look any further than her own home village, home district of Greenwich Village, to see what happens from freezing new development. So she worked so hard for the Greenwich Village Historic District. And I agree, Greenwich Village is lovely. It's a lovely community. It's also a place which went from a place that was affordable when she and her husband lived there in the 40s and 50s to a place where townhouses reliably started $8 million a pop. Okay? So we've preserved a lovely village in Greenwich Village. We've also created a place where no ordinary person can afford to live there. Right? I am not suggesting that historic preservation does not have a major role. I'm the son of an architectural historian. I believe that our most beautiful buildings are an important heritage that need to be preserved. But if we turn our cities into museums instead of living, breathing, changing things, if we don't supply the people need, we risk producing places like Greenwich Village that may be lovely but are not doing what cities are supposed to be doing, which is not just to be beautiful, charming places, but to be places of opportunity and promise for wide groups of people, not just people who can afford $8 million townhouses. Right? And that's what saying no to building does. This is, of course, prices over time between, this is again from the Housing Affordability Report. This is 1996. The saffron line is Auckland. The blue line is the rest of New Zealand. You know, obviously, Auckland has an affordability issue. Right? And that's why, right, it's about, you know, this promoting a more possible city. It's about promoting a city that should grow in order to enable people to enjoy the benefits of the city. It's about creating a city that can grow to enable people to afford to live here. That's why the unitary plan has been talking about easing density restrictions, is the possibility of making a city that is more inclusive, that is more vibrant, that is more dynamic. And it is clear that these housing restrictions have a national impact, right? Which is why these things actually are things that national policy leaders are talking about, right? This is the U.S., right? And in the U.S., you barely get any national discussion of it. But these are, over here, this is the growth, population growth in metropolitan areas. Over here, you have prices. Notice something. The places that grow a lot are not expensive. The places that are expensive don't grow a lot. Okay? This cannot be rationalized just by a view of housing that says there are some areas that are high demand and some areas that are low demand. There's high demand for these places and there are high demand for these places. But in these places, which have names like Atlanta, Dallas, Houston, and Phoenix, each of which have added a million or more bodies to their population of the last decade, it is easy to build. And as a result, it is cheap. And those places, it is enormously hard to build. And as a result, they're not growing and it's expensive. This is the relationship between home prices and local land use regulations across metropolitan areas. This is the relationship between building and local land use regulations. This is Demographia's index. You'll notice Auckland is fairly high up there as part of their more restrictive list here. Another reason, a final reason to think about land use restrictions in building is its relationship with housing price volatility. One of the things we've noticed in the U.S. is that that housing bubbles are not uniform. And this is a picture of the housing bubble. What I'm showing you is price growth between 2001 and 2006 on the x-axis, and price growth between 2006 and 2011 on the y-axis. Okay? It's quite normal for housing markets to experience mean reversion. On average, every dollar that a market's prices go up over 5 years, they go down by 32 cents over the next 5 years, holding other things constant. Past growth is not only not a predictor of future performance, it's a negative predictor of future performance. Right? Now, what this shows is mean reversion on a far greater level. Not 32 cents on the dollar, but 95 cents on the dollar. Every dollar that a metropolitan area saw its prices go up during the boom between 2001 and 2006, it went down by 95 cents over the bust. Now, there are two other things that I want you to take away from this. One of which is there's massive heterogeneity in this. Right? Some areas, like Dallas and Houston, barely saw their prices change at all. Did these places not experience a boom? No, they did, but they built like crazy during this boom. Their prices didn't change because their supply changed. The one city, by the way, that you can notice which is not on the line at all is Detroit, which is sadly the only place that managed to miss the boom and still have the bust. The two places that did spectacularly well relative to those things were Midland, Texas, and Washington, D.C. Apparently being a hometown for George W. Bush was a very positive thing for housing prices during the last decade. But when you try to understand this, this is I've split these cities on the basis of how constrained their supplies are. This is during the boom. I guess this is 80s. No, I just have the 80s boom. Huge difference. Price growth is all heavy in the inelastic areas. The most elastic areas typically skip the boom, right? So the easier that you make it to build, the less likely you are to have these vast spikes one way or the other. And when I would think about, you know, the language that I would use if I were in a central banker role in this is I would not try and say what I think the prices should be in Auckland. I don't actually know what the prices should be in Auckland. It's a hard thing to say. But we do think that having somewhat easier land supplies can lead to less price volatility. And as we know, right, extreme price volatility can take down a whole economy with it, right? So in fact, there are good reasons to be worried about this. Another final reason, and I'll end the talk on this. Another final reason to worry about this is because of the environment. I haven't much talked about green things, but I want to sort of illustrate the nature of cities and the environment with a story about a young Harvard College graduate who, on a beautiful spring day in 1844, went for a walk in the woods outside of Concord, Massachusetts. And he did a little fishing, and the fishing was good because there hadn't been much rain lately. And then he came to cook the fish in a chowder. And as he cooked, the wind flicked the flames to the nearby dry grass. And a fire started, and it spread, and it spread. And by the time it was finished, it had devoured more than 300 acres of prime woodlands, a whole natural ecosystem destroyed due to the clumsiness of this young man. Somewhat oddly, perhaps, today he is revered as the secular saint of American environmentalism. This burner of woods is none other than, of course, Henry David Thoreau, whose book Walden teaches a gospel of what a swell thing it is for us to all live surrounded by nature. But of course, his own life tells a different story, doesn't it? His own life reminds us that we are an extremely destructive species, and often the best way to take care of nature is to stay away from it. As indeed, Thoreau would have done a great deal of good for the woods outside of Concord if he had stayed in Cambridge or Boston instead of going out and lighting fires in the middle of the Concord woods. You know, during his own day, the Concord Freeman called him a flibberty gibbet, which I think was pretty bad for 1844. And, you know, it's hard to think of who else at that point in time did as much damage to the environment as poor Thoreau did. Now, I don't mean to pick on Thoreau, really. Well, I do, really. But his story does make a larger point, which is still relevant today, which is that, in fact, urban living is often contrasted, particularly in the developing world, with extreme rural poverty. And I'll give you that extreme rural poverty is pretty environmentally sensitive, right, in its most extreme form. You know, no energy, living on a subsistence farm in Bangladesh, you're not really creating a whole lot of carbon emissions. That is not a good model for the future of the world, though. Okay, the right model when we think about the future of the world is not rural poverty, but urban versus suburban, living in higher density living versus living in lower density living. And when you do those comparisons, which are, I think, much more real comparisons, cities look very good, particularly because of smaller average living spaces, right, and because of less driving. Together with Matthew Kahn, we tried to measure the average carbon emissions associated with living in different parts of the U.S., both within cities and outside. And we found quite large differences with living in urban cores versus outside them. This is a map for Boston. This is just residential. But we found typically that those highly dense areas at the center of the city typically have far less both residential and transportation emissions than those places on the outside. This is sort of a quantification of it. These are the places with the largest urban-suburban differences. Pounds of CO2, let's say the driving difference, about 8,000 pounds in Nashville, Tennessee, 7,000 pounds between Central City and suburban Boston. And then the differences in home heating, which can be quite substantial because of much smaller units in New York or Boston than outside. Another way of thinking about this is that the great growing economies of India and China see their per capita carbon emission levels rise to the scene in the sprawling United States. Global carbon emissions go up by about 130%. If they stop at the level seen in hyperdense Hong Kong, global carbon emissions go up by less than 30%. Right? Cities are not the enemy of the environment. Cities are a much more environmentally sustainable way to actually build than building low-density living. There's a certain irony in this, right? So within the United States, some of the loudest environmental voices have been those people who have opposed building around the San Francisco Bay. Right? This is, in some sense, the birthplace of the environmental movement. Now, there is no more environmentally sensitive place to build in the U.S. than around the San Francisco Bay. It's a place endowed with enormous amounts of public transit. It's a place with an incredibly benign climate that makes it a great place to build more housing because it doesn't require an unnatural environment. And the thing to always remember on this is when you turn off a building somewhere, it turns on somewhere else. So when it turns off outside of Berkeley, California, it turns on outside of Las Vegas. It turns on outside of Houston. And the results are far more detrimental to the world. So one of the reasons why cities need to get their policy straight, and again, I think I just want to sort of make this point just to be clear to everyone. I'm not advocating that anyone who doesn't want to live in a city should live in a city. I'm an economist, not a lifestyle consultant, for goodness sakes, right? What I'm advocating is freedom, right? What I'm advocating is the ability of, when there is demand for urban areas, for it not to be blocked by excessive nimbyism. What I'm arguing for is that cities that respect people's choices when people want to come to these areas to enable them to build in these areas. And we certainly see as evidence from the high housing prices in Auckland that people want to come to Auckland. That isn't an issue. The issue is how much we want to say no to families who come in. And it's not as if there aren't trade-offs here. There are, and they're very real. But we just need to remember every time we say no to building up, every time we say no to a permit, we're saying no to a family that just wants the advantages of being in a city. And we're making it more costly for other families to live in this area. I don't want to end on a down note, though. I don't want to end with a down environmental note or a down land supply note. I think the central point here is that no matter what the challenges look like, whether in the global economy or in the environment, the track record of our species over the last 3,000 years to work miracles when we're connected with each other, when we borrow ideas from each other, right? Our collaborative ability to do incredible things is just fantastic. I mean, think about what happened in Florence 600 years ago, right? With this chain of genius where Brunelleschi figures about the basic mathematics of linear perspective, passes it along to Donatello, who puts in low relief sculpture on the wall of Orson Michele, passes along to Masaccio, who puts it in the Brancacci Chapel, three-dimensional paintings, that marvelous picture of St. Peter finding a silver coin in the belly of a fish, passes along to that very less than saintly monk, Fra Filippo Lippi, passes along to Botticelli and so forth, the chain of genius, each person figuring out something new and better to do with this idea, creating something absolutely marvelous. This is what cities do. This is why they're precious. This is why this ordinary business of getting land use supply right actually matters for something really magical. And that's why I'm so glad we're having this conversation. Thank you. I can't believe I finished early. I've never finished early before.
4 minutes. That's okay. Good. We'll invite the panelists to the stage if you like. Ed, if you want to.
Sure. In the middle and the.
Thank you. Is this check? Is that on? Can you hear me? Yep. Okay, great. Wow, okay, that was excellent. And so what I've got is a collection here of questions that you've all sent me over the last few weeks and also just over the last few minutes as well. So we'll try and get through as many as we can. Before we do that, of course, I just introduce the panel here. So to my right is the Deputy Mayor of Auckland, probably needs no introduction, Penny Hulse. Obviously Ed. Arthur Grimes, who is the... he's a senior fellow at Motu and a chair of the Reserve Bank and an adjunct professor at the University of Auckland in the Business School. And Professor Robert MacCulloch, who's the Matthew S. Abel Chair in Macroeconomics at the University of Auckland. So welcome to all of you. I think maybe we'll kick this off just by, I've got a sort of four different topics here, we'll look at sort of population growth, and then we'll talk a little bit about housing markets and land use regulations, transport, governance, and then we'll have see what else is in the box. But so if we kick off just by talking a little bit about population growth, you know, you finished off there on a note that the fact that cities can create opportunities for people, I suppose that was the end point there. And you know, the much of the unitary plan discussion has been about population growth and a million people over the next 30 years. And there has been some discussion about, you know, if we could only maybe not have so much population growth, perhaps all of these problems, the costs that we see would go away. So the first question that I want to put to the panel, I suppose, is do you think Auckland should try and limit its population growth in an attempt to avert some of the costs, I suppose, that people bring along with them when they come to a city?
Can I just see if this is working? Yes, it is. Kia ora koutou. Listening to that presentation, which I have to say, Edward, was remarkable. That idea of the chain of genius that exists when cities get it right, it seems to me that rather than being terrified of growth, we should be grabbing it with both hands and saying, what a gift, when you look at around the rest of the country, what's happening. I don't think we should be frightened of it. It's what we do with it and how we manage it. And the endeavours of the unitary plan are saying, let's get that urbanisation correct. Let's allow that chain of genius to happen in a way that works to attract the right people here, but let's not at the same time kill our environment in the process. So we make no apologies for the compact city model, but we want an innovative approach to managing urban density. You've certainly given us some great ideas.
Well, just to show my age, I remember when Auckland passed 500,000 about 1964 or 65. I was rather young at the time, but I was always interested in demographics and economics. So it was a boring place, wasn't it? Terribly boring place. Imagine going back to then. Not only that, it was, you know, ethnically homogeneous. There was a few Maori had moved to Auckland by that stage, but very few Pacific Island, very few Asian. It was a very, very homogeneous, boring city. Now it's just a fabulously thriving, growing city with terrific ethnic diversity, and I just think bring it on.
Well, I'm on the same page as Ed with this, that I think you have to look at the costs and benefits and try to quantify them, and there are obviously benefits not just to the people migrating here but also to the locals as well, as Arthur's describing, increased diversity, more cosmopolitan city, even helping earnings of locals. And then, of course, you have to look and try to quantify the costs, maybe increase congestion, these sorts of issues. We have to be quite scientific about that.
Yeah, if you want to know, I mean, I think that's a, you know, this is a general point that it's more prosaic than much of what I just said, but it is important that I think any new regulation, particularly any major one, really should be subject to cost-benefit analysis, just like a major form of transportation investing. And I think that is really a central point about this, because it is so easy to just let fear dominate the discussion, to just be terrified about, you know, what this new three-story building will do in my neighborhood to the whole thing, where sort of getting it down to economics may be prosaic, but it also, you know, gets rid of irrational fears. And there is such a strong tendency of people to be, you know, terrified of change, that I think moving towards something that's hard and logical can be helpful about that.
Great. Well, I suppose related to that question, one of the ones that's come in from the audience here is talking about what are at the moment we look at population growth and we sort of say, okay, what do we need to do in terms of land use and supply to meet that sort of projected out population growth or whatever we expect the demand to be? And the question here, what are the alternatives to assuming and planning for assumed growth? Maybe I'll point that one at you, Edward. You sort of had some thoughts on that earlier today. You know, what are the alternatives to saying, well, we need to fit another million people in here. Where should we lift the restrictions to meet that?
Well, you know, it's easy to figure out what a city that's frozen in space looks like. I mean, it looks like exactly what you've got now, and then gradually people will be spending to upgrade their apartments, and there should be some crowding into existing apartments, often extra legally. Remember, you know, a great example of a city that tried to freeze its growth by limiting building is Mumbai in the 1960s, right, which adopted a floor area ratio of 1.25. Meant to sort of stop the city from growing, because there was a prevalent view that, you know, all these new people coming to Mumbai were destroying the quality of life in the city. Now, of course, this didn't stop the growth of Mumbai at all, right? It created vast amounts of extra legal dwelling spaces, right? Slums, various sport, and it created unbelievable amounts of sprawl that was not covered by the FAR of 1.25. Right, so it's not even clear that, you know, New Zealand has a great rule of law, India not necessarily so well, so obviously not all the stuff would happen, but it's not entirely clear that you wouldn't have unintended consequences from trying to freeze things that wouldn't be far worse than you can imagine. But, you know, even if it does all work, what you've produced is a city that will become a boutique town that, you know, will get fancier and fancier because there still will be demand to live here, but that will not do its job of providing opportunity for a wider range of people.
Yeah, okay, great. I think the next sort of question is in the area of housing markets and land use regulation. It's sort of following on to what you're talking about, but you know, I mean, I suppose for local governments, they have to weigh up two competing tensions. And on the one hand, you know, maintaining heritage, maintaining character, and I suppose against that is the reality that no suburb sort of exists as an island, that all suburbs are, you know, are in some respects are in substitutes for one another. And so economic policies in one area are going to have flow-on effects to other areas. I suppose what I want to know here is, can you describe to us some of the economic consequences of policies which are a little bit more local in nature compared to a regional approach in nature? And I'll open that up for...
Well, I'm not sure if I quite got the gist of the question, Jeff, but let me just tell you about some work that I've published in the past, which looked across the responsiveness of new housing across all the local authorities in New Zealand, and an economist would call it supply elasticity. If price goes up or construction costs go down, you'd expect more houses to be built. And looked at the relationship of that against the price shocks that you get, or the price spikes that you get when you get an increase in demand, whether it's because of migration or whatever. And it showed very clearly that the towns or the areas that had the largest supply elasticity, most responsive supply, had the least spikes in terms of price. Yeah. Okay, so when you get a migration shock or something into Auckland or to Timaru, which doesn't happen, but if you were, and if they in the place that has the most responsive in housing gets the least price spikes, so the least volatility in housing. So the key thing then is that at a local level is to make sure that when you get this extra demand for housing, that the supply can actually respond quickly. Now, that doesn't say how it should respond, whether it's through more space on the greenfield side or going up or whatever, but it needs to respond quickly.
I agree fully with that. I took your question as more being about the question of the pluses and minuses of having very local control over various things. The sort of history of this in much of the West, right, went from a period of very large scale, you know, often federal in the case of the U.S., interventions in terms of building stuff. So the name that most people associate this is Robert Moses in the 30s through the 60s, who got a very bad and I think unfair rap in Robert Caro's superb book, right? One of the great books on urban policy ever. Hardly a fair and balanced picture, though, of Robert Moses, however. So he was pictured as being the great destroyer of neighborhoods and the great force of evil in the 50s and 60s. But I mean, there was a fair amount of urban renewal that was awful, that was done with fairly callous policies at the large scale level that ignored local interest, which moved towards a complete swing in the other direction in the 60s and 70s, where it was decreed that, you know, what we need is local control over everything, and if we just give each block their ability to decide their own land use decisions and everything else about their life, you know, everything will be worthwhile. Now, that doesn't work so well either, because blocks typically can't agree on anything. When I think about local control, I think of my own hometown in Massachusetts, which is certainly one of the world's great capitals of NIMBYism, although it recently patted itself on the back because it had provided exactly one affordable housing unit, for which every state representative associated with the town came out to celebrate this one unit. But I still remember the famous battle of the bike path, there was some discussion of building a bike path for the town until people decided that this would bring in residents from an also exclusive Massachusetts suburb that happened to be close by, but people were so terrified of this influx of also, you know, entirely homogeneous people who might be wandering into the town that this couldn't possibly be allowed in our town. This is what local control can also give you, right? So it's not a free lunch on this. And the right thing in some sense is to find a balance between the sort of Robert Moses knock them down view, and Moses did a lot of good things as well as bad, and the view of just empowering local groups who often just say no to everything. I certainly think within the US we've gone too far in the extreme of local control, where localities in fact aren't paying attention to the regional costs of saying no everywhere. And I certainly think we should have more of a push on the other side. But it's not true that that's universally true, and the right answer, as in most things, falls in the middle on things. There are pluses and minuses of both errors.
Do you want to?
Sorry, I'm sort of forgetting that there's an audience there, and I'm finding myself nodding and thinking that's exactly what the unitary plan's trying to achieve, which is that understanding if you squeeze here, something needs to pop up somewhere else. And it's not the choice between dealing with the so-called housing affordability crisis by simply opening up more and more and more land. It's also making it easier to look through the removal of density controls in some areas at going up just a little bit. And I think it is finding the way of having that wider regional discussion, which is saying we can be fine-grained enough to protect some of the things that are critical to neighbourhoods, but we still have that wider regional responsibility to make sure that the city works as an integrated whole, and somewhere in the middle of all of that discussion is the right spot.
Great. Pretty straightforward question here. Land banking, is it a problem, yes or no? I don't know if you have any thoughts on it.
Ed, a question, because that's such a hard question, going back to the previous one, is there a literature in economics, Ed, on the optimal size of, say, planning, at what level of local versus regional that...
Less of one than you'd think. I mean, obviously, there is an economic literature on the optimal level of government for various services, right, where the benefits of sort of local competition and local tailoring are weighed off against not taking into account the impacts on other districts, right? So this has been going on since Charles Tebow in 1956. And there's some equivalent of this in planning as well, where typically the small districts tend to be homeowners enclaves that really just say no, both for sometimes good reasons, but also because they're local monopolists who don't want competitors to their own groups. But I wouldn't say it's that well developed, and we don't know the answer. And I have no idea on the issue of land banking in New Zealand as how big of a problem that is. I tend to think that the claims about it tend to be overblown in the U.S. relative to how important it is, but I have no idea about answering it.
Actually, I'll give it a go, Jeff. Land banking is a response to the regulatory environment, okay? So it's the regulations that set up the ability to make money out of land banking. So if one wants to deal with this, one has to think about the appropriate way of freeing up new land for the city to expand. And that may be done through an auction system, auction of development rights, to get people to actually bid for the right to develop, in which case it's a bit like a betterment tax, where the money actually then flows to the local community rather than to the original landowner. Because don't forget, every time you rezone some land to go from farmland to residential land, all you're doing is giving a gift of many millions of dollars to the farmer, essentially. It's just a gift from the community to that individual. And then they will sell that to a land banker, they'll take a cut, the land bank will take a cut, etc. like that. So it's how you free up new land is really important. And I don't think New Zealand has done a good job in thinking about how we should do that.
Great, thanks, Alan. One of the discussions that's, I suppose, been going on the side of the unitary plan is the consensus building group, which the mayor set up, looking at essentially how to fund Auckland's transport deficit of $400 million a year. And they came up with two solutions, essentially the first one to look at increasing rates and other such tools that are already available. And the second option was to do a little bit less of that and have road pricing. And so if we just talk a little bit about road pricing here, what you've already mentioned road pricing, and you're obviously a fan of it. Does road pricing work for all cities? And if it doesn't, what are some of the major reasons, other than political at this stage, in terms of the economics of it, where road pricing perhaps wouldn't stand up?
I'm of course reminded of the old American adage about the question for Mrs. Lincoln after Abraham's assassination is, other than that, Mrs. Lincoln, how was the play? Right. That's the other than the politics. What do you? The politics are everything, as in so much of urban policymaking. I don't, and even the issues of look, I mean, the technology with transponders is fantastic. I mean, you know, you can have people don't need to slow down. You have, you know, unobtrusive things that zap the transponders out of your car. You require everyone to have a transponder. It has charges that change effortlessly day by day, right? The technological aspects of it are easy to handle. They can be done quite cheaply. Now, there are real privacy concerns with that, which I would group in the political. I think actually it would be possible to create a system where those privacy concerns are not felt. But it's all about the politics of making this work. And often the politics then makes you move towards less, you know, scary-feeling technological answers. Rather than requiring everyone to get a transponder, you work with a fairly cumbersome system that London does with its own system, which ends up spending a lot more in terms of the cost of administration. But technologically, I mean, look at the miracles people are able to do with technology, right? I mean, why would it be a problem to have a charge on your car that makes you pay more by time of day on key city roads? So I don't see any particular reason why technologically you shouldn't do it. And as an economist, I feel duty-bound to always and everywhere argue for it, but that does not mean that I'm optimistic that it is likely to be followed anytime soon, precisely because politics are everything. I just think it's important when you put down new highways to at least set the precedent there.
I'll make a brief comment on London, because you mentioned that. You said there's a big political problem putting tolls on existing roads. Do you think there's any merit in a very British way? They seem to introduce the charge in London, but they started off kind of very low and then kind of creep it up sort of over time. Is there any sort of strategy like that to sort of avoid some of those political constraints that you...
It may be, but I think it was just Ken Livingstone was taking a gamble. I mean, it was a unique time. It was really the only major policy thing that he could do, so it was his legacy. He was, he's obviously totally committed to it, both in terms of traffic congestion and for environmental reasons. So there may be, you know, I can tell a political story where it makes sense to start low and move up. I can also say a story which get the pain over quickly because they're not going to like it in any case, and then just, you know, get it done. And I'd leave it to the politicians to figure out what they think is actually doable on it. But, you know, we as economists should always be willing to compromise with whatever we think is doable rather than what we would want as being the
other model is the Stockholm approach, where they look to bring in congestion pricing. There was overwhelming opposition to it. But the deal was they would bring it in and then they'd have a referendum on it 3 years later, I think it was, or 3 or 5 years later. And the referendum, when they came to do it, was, guess what? They liked it. It was passed. Mm. And it was, if you remember, when GST was first introduced in New Zealand, it was the same overwhelming opposition to it within a few months of it being in when the polls showed that people supported it. So it's often the status quo that people will stick with. So just allow people to have a chance to say later on.
Can I just... Just very quickly, I think the critical issue for us is, and it's not an issue of politics, I mean, I'm completely committed to seeing this happen and not afraid of the politics at all, but we do need to be realistic. Unless we commit to a city that has alternatives by way of public transport, a fantastic cycling network, opportunities for people to live affordably within the close confines of the city centre, and we do need to go up a little bit to do that. If we only choose sprawl and then add in congestion charging, that's simply a socially unjust way forward. So we do need to, you know, again, link all of those debates together. And then my glass half full approach is that the politics may drain away more than it has now.
Right. I mean, it's just on this. I mean, you're absolutely right, of course. And it's an irony, right, that congestion pricing and you know, an idea dreamed up by an economist in America in the 50s and in the late 50s, right, ended up being implemented by Red Ken Livingstone, right, who becomes a hero to Chicago school economists. I mean, how weird is this, right? And it's precisely because this is one of those sweet spot of policies that are both sort of economically sound and also not really regressive when done properly, but actually progressive, right? Because he's using that money to fund public transportation. Because even the reduction in transportation in congestion is actually aiding the people who are taking buses, right? And the costs are being paid for disproportionately by the richer people who are driving. So it's one of those things, like allowing more density, that are both sort of about being free and also being about being fair.
Excellent, thanks. And I think we stay on the topic of equity.
I think there's, you know, there's a real divide, I suppose, in Auckland, but in cities generally, in terms of inequality, and you've spoken about that a lot, and it's been written in your book. And one of the questions here is that, you know, there's a lack of opportunities here, particularly for people with varying abilities, for people that are blind or partially sighted or deaf, people that might find it difficult to get access to opportunities. For many people that do have these disabilities, self-employment seems like the only way to make a living. Can you talk a little bit about what impact inequality has in creating a vibrant, successful city, and maybe a little bit on how cities and social mobility go together? How does it help people move socially?
It's a great question. Actually, it's interesting, the specific mix with disability, which I don't always put together, and I need to think for a second about that. But the starting point is, of course, cities are often places of striking inequality. They have been, you know, for thousands of years. Plato talked about it, right? I mean, anytime you see a city, you see two cities, rich and poor. Now, I don't actually think cities should apologize for inequality. I think because typically cities have rich people because cities are fun places to be rich, and cities have poor people, not typically because they make people poor, but because they attract poor people with the promise of economic opportunity, with a better, not with a worse, social safety net, with the ability to get around without a car for every adult, right? Cities aren't making people poor. Cities are making things better for people who are poor, and that's why they're attracting poor people. Now, that doesn't mean that the problems of poverty we should all be blind to, but we shouldn't expect urbanites to bear all the costs of actually dealing with the poor of a nation, or surely the responsibility of everyone in the nation, regardless of where they particularly choose to live. I think that the best weapons we have for fairness is education. And I think it's great that New Zealand has invested so much in early childhood, which is certainly one powerful tool for actually reducing these things. Surely there's more that can continue to be done with education. And I think it's also important to continue to work on what can be done for older people as well. And again, work experience itself is the great forge of human capital there, especially in cities, and it's making sure there aren't barriers to employment for these groups. Disability is a very hard issue in cities, and often cities cannot be as friendly as they might be to disability. But I will make to disabled people, and it's a very important topic. I will make one plea, though, which is that the U.S. Congress passed yet another unfunded mandate with the American Disability Act of 1991, which means they required institutions throughout the country, private and public, to create equal access, right, which imposed. Currently, the Massachusetts Transit Authority spends $110 million a year on a thing called the ride, which provides 2 million rides in taxis for disabled people at $50 a ride. It is bankrupting this. Now, and as a result, they are shutting down a bus service to pay for this. Now, I believe in providing services for people who are disabled, but we should not be giving up on bus service to poor areas to pay for it. They should be paid for at a national level out of whatever we think is the right amount that we should be investing in the social justice, not foisting off these mandates on other individuals because we can look good by them. I mean, it's cheap posturing, in a sense, to require this and not actually pay for it. And I think there's a sort of broader lesson here, which is don't try to do social justice on the cheap by making someone else pay for it. You know, if you want to make things fair, God bless you, I'm with you, but pay for it out of general tax revenues. Don't actually impose the costs on third parties and expect them to pay it, because the result is that you end up, you know, causing pain somewhere else which you hadn't thought about.
I'll just move on now to a question around governance. So this question, I suppose, comes from I'll read it out. The new amalgamated Auckland was established by the current government, which also wrote the governing and enabling legislation for the new city. Since then, the government has removed transport planning strategy responsibilities, threatened to legislate in order to override council decision on planning issues, such as how compact or sprawl the city should be, and has been highly critical of Auckland's preferred transport solutions, although I do admit that this question came in before Friday, so perhaps just the first two. And I think that what the question's getting at here is what decisions are best made at the local level and what decisions should be made at a central government level.
I would just say that actually I like the sort of conflict between local and national government. I think actually good things come out of that. I think actually there are different interests of the representatives. The idea that one group would have a total veto, actually that's far more scary to me, because in fact there are issues that actually the locality will not think about in terms of making its decisions, and there are issues that surely the national government isn't taking into account in terms of their decisions. So the fact that there is disagreement and healthy debate, I think, is enormously healthy, and I just wish there was more of it in the US.
I was on the Urban Technical Advisory Group a few years back, and we were looking at the idea of the one plan, the unitary plan, etc. And we looked at what the system was for similar large-scale plans in overseas countries, mainly Anglo-Saxon countries. And there, for a large-scale plan like this, it was normally approved by the next tier up of government, whether that was a state government or a national government. It wasn't normally approved by the administration that was actually forming it. We had a formal recommendation to that effect that should be what's adopted, and of course central government didn't want a bar of it because then they'd have to be responsible for the plan. So they backed away from that. Interestingly, now once they saw the plan, then they started wanting to get some veto rights into there. So anyway, the usual practice is for the next level of government up to have some form of not necessarily formulate the plan, but they can veto the plan ultimately.
I can't resist chipping in. I think there's two parallel universes at play here. If the plan adequately represents the wishes of the local community, and you know, 1.5 million people is a fairly large local community, then I think that community has every right to make sure that that plan rolls out effectively. The right of veto by central government to decisions made at a local level is untenable, in my view. However, there does need to be some sort of central government guidance, and the legislative right exists there now, to make sure that a local government doesn't act completely out of spec, for want of a better expression. But the unitary plan, as it's being brought together at the moment, and I admit my complete bias on this issue, is actually being developed together with the people of Auckland, and they, as such, have the right to make that decision. If we've got it cataclysmically wrong, then they will make that view known democratically and by a vote at whatever election it turns out to be. But to think that central government should plan for local cities is unacceptable in all ways.
I'll just counter that, Penny, because what you're not consulting is the next million people, the next million people who have yet to move to Auckland. And that's where somebody from outside of the existing group can actually help to represent their interests. And the existing elected representatives do not do that necessarily. You may, and of course you would, Penny, I'm sure, but others may not. And that's where the added level of government as a check and balance for that future population can come in.
I mean, just to take an example of that, and you know, I bow to no one in my admiration for the wisdom of Auckland's current leadership. Take for example a mythical town in Massachusetts that I just happened to live in. Let's just assume that it said no to any building of any form. Not such a mischaracterization of what it does. For the idea that you know, we want no one of any of any heterogeneity to come into this area. Now, there happens to be a state rule that says that, in fact, a developer can bypass local development rules and actually go to the state level if they provide enough affordable housing units within that. That is essentially the state overriding local NIMBYism. Would you really, Deputy Mayor, say that is so wrong? That in fact, it is wrong for the state to allow a back, regardless of how popular these local rules are, to allow a way out for a private landowner on their own land to provide something that was a little bit more densely so they can provide homes for lower-income people. Is that so wrong, Deputy Mayor?
And I think that is a really good question. I think it gets to the heart of the debate that we've got with government at the moment. So I think I had built myself a bit of wriggle room in the initial answer I gave, which was that within certain legislative requirements, we need absolutely to do local planning. However, the legislation as it exists requires us to plan for future growth and within a very distinct set of parameters. In other words, if we simply said we'd like to put up the gates now, there's enough growth, we don't want to destroy anything or change anything, we would simply not be allowed to do that. If we were that stupid, then I would expect some sort of government override. However, the way that the legislation is structured, I think, leads to the development of good local plans. The point that I'm making is that we still need some democratic control over how those plans are rolled out, and I believe that that's exactly what's happening.
Sure.
Thanks, Deputy Mayor. All right, I think we'll actually leave it there, if that's okay. I want to just thank the panellists, particularly I want to thank Deputy Mayor Penny Hulse, who agreed to come on the stage with four other economists. but also thanks to Arthur, thanks Robert, thanks Ed, and thanks to everybody for coming out here. Just end by saying thanks to Motu and the University of Auckland for bringing Edward out here, so thank you very much.